I think what's really difficult for people if they're kind of starting out on this journey, and we get a lot of people who kind of arrive at this podcast because there's something going on, right? They're not feeling well, they've done some research, they've stumbled upon the podcast. And I think a lot of the challenges is that it can just feel kind of completely overwhelming because you're thinking to yourself, in some ways, a prescription is so much easier just to get your head around, right? I go to the doctor, they tell me what to do. When you first start working with clients, let's take the analogy of being a personal trainer, right? You don't just get people in the gym and get them slinging weights. There's like work to be done to kind of create some kind of early foundations to kind of work out where you're going. If someone's kind of listening to this and they're really early on that journey, is it best to start cleaning up your diet, removing foods, change what you're putting on your body, all of those sorts of things? Or do you see much faster process when people just go, right, I'm going to partner with somebody, I'm going to get tested, I'm going to get the data, I'm going to, you know, where is the best place for people to start?
It's a good question. And there's not really a black and white answer for that, because each person is going to have their own best journey. Some people will react really, really well to just tidying up their diet, to doing what's obvious, right? If you are eating McDonald's three meals a day, or if you're not eating breakfast and not eating lunch and you're having an Indian takeaway every night and you drink, you know, half a bottle of wine or three beers at the end of the day, right? Making basic changes to your diet. So you're having breakfast, you're eating vegetables, you are eating protein, you're balancing your blood sugar, you know, doing the things that are obvious are going to make a really big difference. So I say this thing all the time, which is, in any case, and I work with some very, very complex cases, and I also work with some things that are really much more straightforward. And in both of those things, and all sometimes especially with the complex cases, I say this thing, which is, in medicine there is a saying, when you hear hooves, first look for horses, then look for zebras, and then look for unicorns, right? Don't jump straight to unicorns. If you're sitting in your living room and you hear horses, I mean, if you hear hooves clopping past the window, if you look out the window, do you expect to see a zebra or a pony? You know, you have to do what's obvious first. And a lot of people want to jump straight to the fancy thing, or they want a magic bullet. But actually, the way the body works is common sense, and usually you have to do what's obvious first. So if you are stressed up the wazoo, if you are eating really well, but your levels of stress are really high all the time, you're in a terrible marriage, or you really hate your job, right, then broccoli is probably not the answer, right? You have to have some common sense approaches to things, right? You need to manage your stress, and you need to have a think about what do you need to change in your life. So some people have the ability to do that for themselves, and then other people need some help with that. And so one of the things that I do when I'm seeing somebody for the first time, especially with if you've had symptoms for a while, if this is a recent onset of symptoms, then you may be able to work it out for yourself. And if some things are obvious to you, if you are just eating McDonald's and takeaway all the time, and it's going to be obvious that you need to start cooking for yourself and making common sense interventions, then that's probably something that you can do. But if you've been having gut problems for 10 or 15 years and they don't really change, or it's very difficult for you to pinpoint, you know, if you make this change or that change, sometimes it helps and sometimes it doesn't help, which is really common with gut symptoms, then you probably do need to have some stool testing, some breath testing, you know, have somebody walk you through your history and help you pinpoint where to make the changes, because there is nothing more frustrating than reading things online, trying this person's gut program, reading this book, trying that supplement program that's in the book, and just going round and round and round and round in circles. And I see people spend a lot of time and a lot of money doing things that are theoretically the right thing, but are not the right thing for that person.
Yeah, or in the wrong order.
Or in the wrong order. Wrong order. The right order changes everything.
Yeah. And just looping back around to where we started the conversation, which was this idea around the kind of 20% kind of eating gluten and 20% not, because I think that's a really interesting thing for people listening to this about whether you should or shouldn't have it in your diet. So That's interesting, right? Firstly, it's the quality of the gluten. It's not just about having it, but it's kind of where you get it from. But that 20% that you were talking about, are we talking exclusively there about people that are celiac, or are we saying even some people that aren't celiac for perhaps the makeup of their bacteria, what's going on? Are there certain people that actually just should be avoiding gluten?
Right, so remember that gluten is a protein. So when I'm talking about 20% shouldn't be eating gluten, what I'm talking about is immune-mediated inflammatory reactions to gluten. So celiac disease is somewhere between 1 and 3% of the population. So the numbers are a bit unclear. It was thought to be 1% for a very long time, and now it's probably between 1 and 2 or 3% of the population. But then you have a much larger chunk of the population, which makes up the other kind of 17%, which have what's called non-celiac gluten sensitivity, NCGS. And the difference between those two is subtle but very specific. So with celiac disease, you have a very specific type of damage that is done to a structure in the small intestine called the villi. So when you have celiac disease and you eat gluten, gluten triggers your immune system to start napalming the villi in your gut. And to have celiac disease, you have to have that type of damage. But celiac disease is not principally a disease of the gut. It is a systemic inflammatory immune-mediated autoimmune disease that affects the brain. It attacks and damages the brain. It attacks and damages the skin. It can attack and damage any tissue in the body as well as the gut, right? To be celiac disease, it has to affect the gut, but it can affect and does affect every other tissue in the body. The reproductive tract, endocrine system, neurological system, skin, everything else, cardiac, everything else. So non-celiac gluten sensitivity is also immune mediated. It also is inflammatory. It also affects every and other tissue in the body. So you eat gluten, your immune system causes inflammation. That inflammation can affect your thyroid, can affect your muscles, your bones, your joints, your brain, your skin, your eyes, everything. But with non-celiac gluten sensitivity, you don't have that characteristic gut damage. And with non-celiac gluten sensitivity, it can be autoimmune, which is one part of your immune system, or it can be not autoimmune. It can be cellular, which is a different part of the immune system. So both of those things are pro-inflammatory. They can affect every tissue in the body. With celiac disease, it has to affect the gut in a specific way.